afternoon, brothers and sisters, and a warm welcome and greeting to all guests and visitors worshiping in our midst this afternoon. The council has the following announcements. The council hopes to meet, the Lord willing, this coming Tuesday evening at 7:30 p.m. in the church building, the Lord willing. Also, attestations have been requested by brother and sister Alan and Faye Mull to the United Reformed Church at Lacombe, Alberta. And attestation has been requested by brother and sister Stuart and Sherry Harsevoort and their three baptized children to the Canadian Reformed Church at Carmen, East Manitoba. Our offerings today are for the work of Mission Prince George. And one additional announcement to those this morning is that there will be an open house this week, Saturday, here in this church building for the 60th wedding anniversary for brother and sister George and Jenny Weymakamp from 2 o'clock to 3:30 p.m. As you've also received notice in your mailboxes. With these announcements now, let us stand and rise and lift up our hearts to the Lord. Congregation of the Lord, where does our help come from? Receive now the Lord's greeting. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Amen. Let us praise our God together in song by singing from hymn 5, all stanzas. Just sung All thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Let us together do so by professing our Catholic and undoubted Christian faith as we have it put in Hymn 1, the Apostles' Creed, set to music, Hymn 1. Seek his blessing over the remainder of our worship this afternoon. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we come together in prayer this afternoon and we give you thanks that in your providence you have allowed us to gather here for worship. And we pray that you will also be with those who in your providence you have hindered from gathering with us. And we pray that you will also be with them and bless them on this Sunday afternoon. Lord, be also with those who are away from us, traveling, those who are ill and sick, and those who are shut in. And Lord, we pray that you will also be with any of those in our church family who do not desire or no longer desire to worship you, whose hearts have hardened to you and to your call to worship. We pray that you will work repentance and change in their lives. Father, we thank you that we can gather here this afternoon in freedom as your people and be assured of your grace and peace, assured that we are your beloved children through Jesus Christ, and assured that you are the holy God who also desires and works to create a holy people in your image and likeness. So, Father, to that end, bless the reading and proclamation of your word this afternoon. Instruct us how to live in relationship to you and in relationship to one another, so that we might be a holy people, a people who are united in heart and purpose, united in love for you and likewise for one another. So, Father, we pray for your blessing and grace to be upon us as we hear your truth proclaimed and work it in our hearts by your Spirit. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us join our hearts together in song again by now singing from Psalm 26, stanzas 2 and 3.
Lord, I'm
invite you now to turn with me in your Bibles to two passages of Holy Scripture. First, we will read together from Matthew chapter 18, the verses 15 through 20, followed by also a reading from the book of Hebrews, Hebrews 12. We read these passages in connection with what the church confesses about church discipline, as we find it in the Heidelberg Catechism Confessed, question and answer 85, which we will look at this afternoon. First, let us read in connection with that from Matthew 18, when we begin our reading at verse 15. Hear now God's holy and inspired word. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. So far, our reading from Matthew. Let us turn now to the letter to the Hebrews. We'll read together from Hebrews 12, verses 1 through 14. Hebrews 12, beginning at verse 1, we read, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as it seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, that we may share his holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Therefore, lift your drooping hands and strengthen your weak knees, and make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather healed. Strive for peace with everyone and for the holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. So far, our reading of God's Word. Let us now turn to the Church's Confession of God's Word as we find it in Lord's Day 31, question and answer 85. We find this Lord's Day in the back of our Book of Praise on page 547, question and answer 85, continuing its treatment on the keys of the kingdom of heaven, the first being the preaching of the Holy Gospel. Now we also consider the key of church discipline. And in question and answer 85, the question is asked, how is the kingdom of heaven closed and opened by church discipline? The answer, according to the command of Christ, people who call themselves Christians but show themselves to be unchristian in doctrine or life are first repeatedly admonished in a brotherly manner. If they do not give up their errors or wickedness, they are reported to the church, that is, to the elders. If they do not heed also their admonitions, they are forbidden the use of the sacraments, and they are excluded by the elders from the Christian congregation, and by God himself from the kingdom of Christ. They are again received as members of Christ and of the church when they promise and show real amendment. So far, our reading of the church's confession this afternoon. After the proclamation of God's word, let us respond in song by singing from Psalm 33, stanza 3, Psalm 33, stanza 3, following the sermon. Beloved congregation of our Lord Jesus Christ, in our world today, church discipline, and even just the word discipline for that matter, have fallen on hard times. For many, these words have negative connotations. Something that is mean-spirited, harsh, punishing, cruel, and uncaring. And this is a fairly recent development, for the word discipline is related to the word disciple. So we can easily see which disciple and discipline have to do with learning. That's why schools and universities formerly used to speak of the disciplines. The disciplines of math and English and so on. But over time, discipline has become associated with being critical and judgmental. And therefore, when it comes to the practice of church discipline, many will attack it and say it's too controversial, too oppressive, and therefore unnecessary, plainly unkind. And there are others who have been unjustly treated, and if and when church discipline was carried out in a poor and unloving manner, and we should be sympathetic to that, certainly, but we should also be careful not to throw the baby out with the bathwater. For the Bible is clear that church discipline is a biblical requirement and a necessity, an institution given by Christ himself to the church, and evidence of Christ's love for his people. And if we know our own hearts well enough, we know that we love to feel free to roam wherever we like and do whatever we like, live however we like, without having any accountability. It's appealing to our sinful nature not to be looked after. But God wants to look after us and, if necessary, discipline us, and he has commanded the church to do that on his behalf. And here it is important for us to realize that, just as with the key of preaching, it is not ultimately the preacher whose words are coming to us. It is Christ who is speaking to you through the preaching. So also with the key of church discipline. It is not the church or the elders or the pastor who are out to discipline you, first and foremost. It is ultimately Christ who disciplines you, and ultimately for your good. And therefore, I preach God's word to you this afternoon as summarized under this theme. The second key Christ entrusts to the church is the practice of Christian discipline. We'll consider first self-discipline, secondly mutual discipline, and thirdly church discipline. Well, to be clear, discipline does not start with the elders or pastors. It starts with God working in your heart. It starts with you. To use the words of Hebrews 12, you fixing your eyes on Jesus Christ, that is, putting before your eyes the most beautiful, incredible person in the universe, Jesus Christ, in comparison with whom everything else pales in comparison. Everything else is worthless and considered loss, says Paul. If Christ is the image that we have fixed in our mind's eye, then you will begin to throw off and lay aside every sin that hinders you from reaching that prize at the end of the race, that glorious inheritance in store for us. So that is what keeps us racing. You see something so beautiful in your sight that you don't want to miss it, and you're willing to give up everything else in order to get that prize, throwing off everything that is weighing you down and slowing you down. Well, it might be your love of things like sports or video games or work or money or your group of friends, or it might even be your family. All of these things might be good things even, but they might be slowing you down. So throw them off. Throw it off if it is keeping you from Christian communication, from worshiping every Sunday with a clear and undistracted mind, or if it's keeping you from meditation upon God and upon His Word. The Bible never pretends to think that this is going to be easy. In fact, it may be painful to let go of these things that we've grown to love. But Hebrews 12 says, for the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant. But guess what, though? It yields full fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. So God wants to train us so that we grow in holiness and in righteousness. And so He puts these things on our path, whatever they may be, maybe difficulties and hardships, to teach us more and more to lean upon the saving arms of Jesus Christ. God wants His children to be holy because, He says, without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. That means your lifestyle matters. Your lifestyle choices matter a lot. It matters just as much as having the right doctrine, because your lifestyle is your doctrine lived out. As the saying goes, show me how you live, and I can tell you what you believe. Isn't that true? Show me how you live, and I can tell you what you believe. Well, the truth is that grace always, always has a transforming effect on a person. No person touched by grace will remain unchanged. And so, brothers and sisters, if we look at our own lives, praise God if you see evidence of transformation in your own life. And if you cannot see that, then ask yourself if you're disciplining your own life, making every effort to live at peace with God and in love toward all people, and live and be holy. And just think how amazingly joyful would be the work of elders and pastors in your midst if they knew that every person in our midst of this church was exerting themselves to the utmost extent to strive for God and for His holiness, empowered by His Spirit. If the elders and pastors knew that you wanted to meditate at the end of every day to consider if there's anything slowing you down from getting to know God better, getting to know His grace better in Jesus Christ. If they knew that you were serious about practicing self-control in a day and age when anything goes. Well, if this was the case, the consistory would have no more work left. And that would be wonderful. And so some good questions we can ask ourselves when it comes to this, when it comes to making decisions about life and about work and about who to marry and what hobbies to pursue, we ask ourselves, is this going to help me in my Christian life? Is what I'm putting my time and my energy towards drawing me closer to my Lord Jesus Christ? Or am I just adding distractions? Do I need this to help me know Jesus Christ better? Brothers and sisters, practice what every godly saint throughout the centuries past has practiced, and that is self-discipline, self-control. The old man of our sinful nature, whom we'll hear about in a few weeks' time when we come to Lord's Day 33, the old man of our sinful nature, whom we are called to put to death, I can guarantee you, he won't die by you doing nothing. He will not be killed by passivity or inactivity. This means that we must be a people who practice discipline in the first place towards ourselves, so that we are willing to see the sin and darkness in our own lives first, and then looking to Christ and receiving the resources only He can give, His righteousness, His forgiveness, His Spirit. We are empowered to live holy lives. As Paul says to Timothy, his protege, train yourself for godliness. For while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, and it holds promise for the present life and for the life to come. And those who love to work out and train rigorously, they know how hard it is to stay at a premium fitness level, to remain at that peak level of excellence. But they know that it's worth it. They know that it takes discipline. There are things that you have to give up, lots of things. You must give up much of your time. You must give up chocolate cake and potato chips among them. Well, spiritual training, like physical training, requires great discipline as well. But in the end, it will be supremely worth it. That's why we train, to see the Lord, who is holy, 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 as we sang earlier. All the suffering and all the hardship that must be endured along the way will all be worth it, because we will have sight of our Lord Jesus Christ in all His beauty and glory. And so we discipline ourselves. Brothers and sisters, force yourselves to practice the spiritual disciplines of scripture reading and prayer, and have Christian conversations, and see if you will not reap the reward of righteousness and holiness from it. And start that today. Seek God above all else. Search your soul in light of God's Word to find out where you need to grow, and if necessary, seek the help of others who can help you identify the areas that you may not notice and know where you need to grow. But most of all, pray for the Spirit to lead you and to show you the way. And may we all encourage each other as we seek the same pursuit of holiness in our lives. This brings us now to our second point, looking at mutual discipline. Well, early on in the history of the world, someone asked the question that has been asked ever since, whether out loud or not: am I my brother's keeper? Cain asked. Am I my brother's keeper? The right answer then, and still today, is that we are all called to be our brother's keeper. That's the way God would have it. That comes out in a number of commands in Scripture, which we see all over the place, which teach us how we are to treat one another. They're sometimes called the one another commands. They include among them, love one another, forgive one another, live in peace with one another, and so on. And as a family of Christ, therefore, we have, with the Spirit indwelling in us, we have the ability and the calling to teach and admonish and encourage and build each other up. Salvation is never separated from accountability within the membership of the Church of Jesus Christ. You cannot say, I'm a Christian, but I don't need to go to church, and I don't need anyone else. Can't say that. God's people throughout the centuries have rejected that nonsense. For the church is a communion. It's a body where we live with each other, where we need each other, and where we need to mutually discipline each other. Now, when we speak about church discipline, there are two ways you can divide the subject. You can divide it in two areas. We speak in one way of formative church discipline, and secondly, of corrective church discipline. Formative church discipline and corrective church discipline. Formative church discipline is all the teaching that we do, all the preaching, all the positive instruction, all the modeling of a good example, all the Bible studies, all the books and articles that we read and share with one another. And when it comes to most sins, formative church discipline is key. It's foundational. We must model personal holiness and encourage each other in meaningful ways. How many sins are prevented from happening because believers give each other mutual instruction and practice Christian affirmation and provide each other with good and upbuilding examples of godly living? This is formative church discipline, something I believe was stronger in the past, especially in the earliest days of the Canadian Reformed churches, when commitment in a Bible study was a given. Now it's basically the opposite. Why is that? Why do we have so many, what do we call them, free floaters who attend no Bible study at all? Especially in the post-young people age bracket. Now you may think you don't need it, or you don't have the time for it, but that's not true. And plus, that's only half of the matter anyways, for others need you and could be encouraged greatly by your presence and participation. The point is that we all need and need to seek friendship and fellowship within the church. That's what the church is there for. One should not be like a sheep that's wandering on the around the fringes, around the edges of the flock. That worries the shepherds of Christ's church, because those are the sheep that are easiest for the wolves to pick off, to lure away, to entice with temptations of this world. If you know your own heart well enough, you know that it is extremely dangerous to be alone at the edge of the flock, because we are so prone to wander. In this regard, I think that I've been here long enough to say this, though we in this congregation have some excellent Bible study groups already in place, we could have better cross-generational relationships between members younger and older. This is one of the advantages of having ward groups, which some churches have gone to, or something along those lines, in order to integrate people, new or not new, who may not all be at the same stage of life, in exactly the same life situation. And maybe you've noticed, as I have, if you look at a map of Barrhead ever, that Barrhead slices up quite nicely into four geographical quadrants or zones which would leave no one out of the mix. I'm only offering the suggestion and leaving it to any of you to make this suggestion a reality. Now, where is all this going? Is the pastor on a tangent? Isn't this sermon on church discipline? Well, yes, precisely. In order for church discipline to have any effect whatsoever, to have the ability to bring change, then there needs to be real and meaningful spiritual communion and connections and conversations with each other. And so we should not only talk about the weather or hockey or work after worship, but also our response to the word preached. There's a topic for discussion after the sermon. Or how about the areas where you're going to practice self-denial about all the things you want to do and don't have time to do, but in the coming months, how you can spend more time in the Word of God and in prayer. And how to be more involved in the church family, maybe when the big season, the church season starts up again in September, when lots of opportunities come up. And how about also the matter of discussion on how to see our evangelism as a community increase and thrive, and what we can do better. When it is natural to have real conversations about real life, and make no mistake about it, spiritual life is as real as you can get. Only then can we start practicing effective, corrective church discipline. So what is that? Well, corrective church discipline is where you have to say, "Hey, Tom or Sally, you're wrong here. Look what the Bible says. You need to make life changes here and here, because what you're doing is destructive to God's name and to your neighbor and to your church. You need to repent, because you're dragging God's good name through the mud by your actions, and you're bringing ridicule and insult upon the church and upon Christ. Do you see that?" And so, corrective church discipline is that step-by-step process outlined in Matthew 18. Christ does not want one of his sheep to be lost. He wants us to look after one another. And part of that means if someone sins against you, you must gently and humbly show them their fault between the two of you. You don't start telling everybody else. Don't start firing up the gossip mill. No, you go to them and you say, "I've been sinned against." For if you don't do that, listen, you are partly to blame. That's right. Whoa, wait a minute. That's a pretty radical statement, Pastor. Me? Partly to blame? Yes. For you have not done what you were supposed to do. You left them alone when they were in their greatest need for help. By ignoring the situation, turning a blind eye towards it, refusing to say what you know you ought to say, you become complicit in the wrongdoing. By virtue of your inaction, you show that you, in fact, the Bible says, hate your brother or sister. That's what Leviticus 19, verse 17 says. You shall not hate your neighbor in your heart, But you shall reason frankly with your neighbor, lest you incur sin because of him. And so any discussion about the offender, the one who sins, must not be behind their back. We understand that, I hope. And I hope we, even more, that we practice it. But rebuking is a Christian duty. And yet I know that this is an area where many of us fall short, and I include myself in this too. Having not expressed concern for sin that we've seen without dealing with the sin directly. We all know how easy it is to ignore, to gossip, but it takes great courage and great love and great care to confront. And that is what Christ calls us to do, and that's what brings us to church discipline in the widest sense, in which we'll see now in our third point. So what if someone doesn't listen to your rebuke or your correction? Well, according to Matthew 18, you take along with you another trusted person, a mutual confidant perhaps, a mature believer preferably, and you try again. But what if that also fails? Well, then Matthew says you take it then to the church. This is where things move into formal church discipline. By church discipline, God has given the authority to the elders and leaders of the church to keep his church holy. Of course, there's much brokenness in the church, but that brokenness is not to be grudgingly accepted if it can be changed, if it can be healed. This is where grace challenges us. Grace is not an easy road where we turn a blind eye to sin and just say whatever. Far from it. And so there will be times when the leadership of the church has to tell someone, I know, brother or sister, that you are claiming to be a Christian, but we have to treat you like a non-Christian because you won't stop lying to yourself and repent. We love you, but you may not receive the Lord's Supper because you're not following the Lord Jesus Christ in the way he has set out in his word, as far as we are able to see. And so we beg you to show true repentance. And when people see members of the church voluntarily coming clean and confessing sin and truly repenting before God and to their neighbor perhaps, it builds and creates credibility for the gospel. Facing sin honestly means that we believe what we say we believe, that Christ died for sinners, of whom I am the worst. This kind of living answers the question, are you fully committed to following your Lord Jesus, doing all that living for him entails? But very often, sadly, we would rather hide sin than confront it. That is what our human hearts want. We simply do not want to have other people have that kind of outside authority in my life. We want to resist that and say, what business do you elders or you brother or sister have in my life telling me that I'm doing wrong? And that's a bad sign to see. It shows unrepentance. And so what that ultimately or unfortunately leads to so often is that discipline is avoided because of fear of consequences. Maybe the unrepentant member has a lot of influence in the church, maybe deep pockets, maybe leadership abilities or whatnot. Or maybe it would disturb a family in the congregation who would rather want to see things be left alone, who are happy with the status quo. But you see, once the matter of discipline gets to the leadership, the status quo of sin needs desperately to be disturbed. The apple cart needs to be flipped over, basically. The sinner has become hardened in their sin often by then and locks themselves on the road to their own peril. And that is why church discipline is always a call of love, to turn the unrepentant person back to the way of God. The elders of this church are called to love people dearly as they would want to be loved themselves. And that is why they must ask the tough questions and make the tough visits. They have the responsibility before God and the calling from Jesus Christ himself to care for his sheep, to show his love for you, showing patience and understanding, but also when necessary to bring strong words of admonition and warning when sin is not being dealt with rightly. And then, if after multiple attempts have no success, according to Christ's command, the church is commanded to treat the unrepentant person as an unbeliever, as a heathen. To treat someone as a Gentile or tax collector. That means treating them as one outside the family of God. And the elders can tell you there is no more difficult time, no more harder time you'll ever experience in a consistory room than when the discussion or the decision must be made to proceed to education or the steps that lead up to it, with public announcements and so on. Which is, by the way, leading to no better destination than withdrawal. Even the withdrawals we heard this morning, sadly. But there does come a time when excommunication is the only option left to us. Like the moment that a group of doctors have no other remedy to choose from to apply except for chemotherapy. It's when the elders have to say, brother or sister, you do not belong to the family of Jesus Christ. Your unrepentant actions have forced us into no other choice. We would much rather not have to do this. We can no longer affirm that your profession of faith is genuine and real and true, and therefore we cannot say with certainty that your eternal salvation is secure, as far as we can see. How we wish we would see you soften your heart and turn away from sin and be filled with God's grace. And so the punishment that the church applies is spiritual. We don't hand out fines. We don't hand out penalties. We don't administer corporal punishment. We don't put people in prison or banish them by removing them out of our lives completely and cutting off all communication with them and excluding them from coming to worship services or even to family events. No, though some churches do practice that, what is called shunning, that is not the case with true biblical church discipline. The church doors, wherever they are, always stand open. They're never closed, never shut. But the excommunicated member must be treated like an unbeliever. That means they must be evangelized. They must learn the gospel so that they're brought to a true meaning of the gospel and what Christ has done to bring salvation. As long as they are still living and breathing, then we have opportunity to reach them. And we must take those opportunities and never cut off communication as far as we are so able. But there does come a time when we have to recognize that for all the efforts and attempts being made, there has been no fruit born from it. And such a fruitless branch cannot remain in the tree, lest it spread its disease to all the living members, the living branches. The Bible describes this in 1 Corinthians 5 in terms of bad yeast spreading through the whole batch of dough. That bad yeast must be removed and taken out, lest it spread. And so please understand, brothers and sisters, that excommunication is nothing other and nothing less than the termination of communion. Excommunication. And that it is the act of a member's self-chosen withdrawal from the church. It's not good riddance. It's a painful recognition and a release that those who claimed to be and perhaps acted like brothers and sisters perhaps for a long time, for many years, have shown otherwise by their lifestyle and their doctrine and their choices. If this kind of excommunication is done in a biblical, God-honoring way, then God in heaven will confirm what the elders do here on earth. And God will affirm both the failure and the success of reconciliation. In conclusion, then, the church is like a field that constantly needs to be weeded. It's like a tree that constantly needs pruning, like a flock that constantly needs tending, and a house that constantly needs renovation, and a bride that must constantly be made holy for her bridegroom. Sin happens. Sin happens. We admit that. And we should not even be surprised by it whatsoever if we hear about a certain sin. But let us pray that repentance may always follow. It must. It has to. Pray that church discipline would never suffer here in this church, because we need it, and we know we need it. Sin is never ignored in Scripture. God did not cover up the sin of Adam and Eve in the garden, or Noah's drunkenness, or David's adultery, or Peter's denial, but he confronted them, and they were the better for it. The church should therefore set the standard for coming clean, for showing the freedom that there is from the bondage of sin through repentance and faith on a daily basis. But if you neglect church discipline, if you do away with it, if you neglect to correct church members humbly and lovingly about their sin, then the church will no longer be a holy church community. It'll lose one of the three marks of a true church, as the Belgian Confession, Article 29, spells out. For church discipline is foundational, that we should hold ourselves to a higher standard than the one that the world sets for us. Striving to be holy as God is holy. We realize that church discipline will not prevent sin from causing damage to the church, won't prevent sin from happening. But it is what Christ himself instructed, that the kingdom of God would be closed to the unrepentant, but reopened for those who repent and promise and show real amendment. We know that Christ, brothers and sisters, went out of his way in love for us to save us. And he expects us to do the same in our love for each other. And that is why the measure of true love is not to refrain from church discipline, but to faithfully practice and lovingly administer church discipline for the salvation of souls, even to the point of excommunication, if necessary, in order to show what true Christ-like love really looks like. Amen. Afternoon, we will also give thanks to the Lord for the upcoming this week anniversary for our brother and sister George and Jenny Waymacamp, who will to celebrate it, Lord willing, this week Thursday. We will also remember the departing members of our church family, the Moll and Harsevoort families that will be leaving us shortly. We will also remember before the Lord the friend, the acquaintance of our brother Matt Tabak, by the name of Dale Snyder, a friend who had suffered multiple strokes, and we pray for his well-being of body and soul. With this in mind, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God and Father, we thank you for your wisdom and for your love for us, your people, that you love us enough to discipline us so that we might grow in holiness, so that we might grow in righteousness and peace and abound in every good way and work. Help us, O Lord, to see that your discipline, though painful for the moment, is for our ultimate good, and it is evidence of your care and concern, and it's reminiscent of how you went out of your way to save us. And so we pray that we too may go out of our way to exercise that same love and care for one another through mutual discipline in relationships of accountability. And so, Father, strengthen us as members of the communion of saints here in Barrhead, that this may be true of us. We pray that we would be more faithful in practicing these things in both formative and corrective ways of discipline. And we pray that you would use these means for the unity and purity of your church and for the salvation of sinners, and ultimately for your honor and glory. Father in heaven, we thank you for this beautiful summer day and for these summer months where we may enjoy the wonder of creation in full color and prime growth. And this may also be a time when the pace of life may slow down somewhat for many of us to enjoy holidays and vacations and traveling, and time away from regular work, spending perhaps more time in your creation and in the great outdoors. We pray that you will give us traveling mercies wherever we go. Grant also that in this time we will not forget about you or look away from you to provide us with everything we need for body and soul, that we may walk faithfully with you and before you. Father in heaven, we bring before you the friend, the acquaintance of Brother Matthew Tabak. We pray for Dale Snyder, who suffered all the series of strokes recently. We pray that you will preserve his life if it be your will. Grant him health of body, but more importantly also health of his soul, that he may know, that he may trust in you, that his life is in your hand, in your control, even in this critical time. Father, we pray that you will be with our departing members, the Mull and Harsevoort families. We pray for your blessing upon their moves, and as they settle into their new home places, Father, guide and keep them and make them a blessing in their new congregations, that they will soon find their place there in the midst of your saints. Father, we also pray for your blessing upon our brother and sister George and Jenny Weymakamp and their family as they celebrate their 60th wedding anniversary this week. Lord, though through many ups and downs, you have been with them and you have been faithful to them over these many years. And so with them, we praise and thank you for your goodness and your blessing. And Father, we pray that their marriage may provide a good and strong example for other marriages in this congregation to follow. Father, cause the marriages of your people in this church to be strong and healthy in Christian character. Bless our families and our homes. Bless parents in their parenting and children as they obey their parents and submit to their authority. And we also pray for those who are single in our midst. Make them also a blessing in this congregation, that they may see the part that you have given them to play as we all together serve you in true Christian fellowship and love. Father, as we go now from here, we pray for your blessing upon us further yet this Lord's Day, and grant that we may go our ways from here with a strong sense of your peace and favor and blessing upon us. So, Father, hear us, we pray, and accept the offerings that we bring before you. For we ask this all of you in Christ's name alone. Amen. The Lord now gives you opportunity to bring your offerings of thankfulness to him as collected by the deacons. And afterwards, let us stand and sing from hymn 56, all the stanzas. receive now the blessing of the Lord and go your way into this week with peace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.